Now, this Brexit business has discombobulated the British political classes, with the likes of Nick Clegg and Alistair Campbell, not exactly natural soulmates, desperately seeking ways to reverse last year's referendum result, while sundry Tory Brexiteers urge Mrs. May to throw her toys out of the pram and declare a sort of Brexit UDI. Meanwhile, much of the British media treats everything coming out of Brussels as wisdom personified. Well, anything London says is a load of old cobblers. Now, that, of course, may be true, but it rather glosses over the fact that whatever the scale of our own troubles, the EU has big problems of its own, from separatism in Spain to extremism in Austria to massive Italian sovereign debt to the inconvenient truth that the most powerful country in the EU will take months to form a new coalition government, which is a bit of a pain for Mutti Merkel, when the rest of the EU is looking to her for leadership. One man who's seen the EU close up and had to grapple with its Byzantine ways and myriad problems is Yanis Varoufakis, former finance minister of Greece. This is his take of the week.
This week, an investigative reporter in Malta, Daphne Caruana Galizia, was blown up to pieces for having exposed tax cheats in her country. Simultaneously in Austria, a party founded by Nazis became kingmaker after the general election in that country. And regional government officials were arrested for sedition in Catalonia for purely political purposes. When during the great financial crash, some of us were warning that 2008 was our generation's 1929, and unless we dealt efficiently with the resulting socioeconomic crisis, a postmodern version of the 1930s was upon us, we were dismissed as doomsayers. The European Union's denial that the economic and financial architecture of the Union was not up to the task of handling the great banking crisis of 2008 has delegitimized the European project. The natural repercussion has been the insurgency of anti-European nationalism. I do not care what it will cost, I just wanted my country back, is the proud message heard throughout England after the Brexit referendum. Alas, neither the Britons nor the Germans are going to claim their country back by building electrified border fences and recoiling into the bosom of the nation state. No nation state can deal on its own with a quadruple crisis of mounting private debt, burgeoning public debt, historically low investment levels, and the growing discontent from inhuman levels of inequality. We face a historic task. How to steer a sensible course between the authoritarian incompetence of the European Union, which is the cause of the European Union's fragmentation, and the fantasy that new borders will help us restore the greatness of our countries. In short, we need a European New Deal instead. Utopic? Perhaps, except that the alternative is a dystopia.
Thanks to Toad in London. Yanis is with us now. Welcome to the programme. Let me begin with a clarification. Are you saying that if the EU continues on its current course, it's finished?
It is utterly unsustainable. The Eurozone is the core of the European Union. And the euro is a currency designed to fail. Not intentionally, unintentionally perhaps. And if the euro fails, the European Union is gone.
As a result.
It doesn't necessarily mean, I'm not prognosticating the disintegration of the euro, but what I am saying is that, take France for instance, France is condemned to stagnate in the long term, given the relative structure of its economy and that of Germany. When you fuse together such disparate economies by means of a fixed exchange rate regime, then France, whatever President Macron does, is going to be a cesspool
and can't be competitive
discontent.
With that currency.
It can never be competitive and can never create the jobs that are necessary in order to stabilize the political economy of France.
But let me pick some of the things you said on the politics. I mean, explain, for example, how what you call the authoritarian incompetence of Brussels, which you said was producing the fragmentation, how is that responsible for the rise of Scottish nationalism or Catalonian separatism? It's not, is it?
Well, it is not responsible for the rise of Scottish nationalism.
Or Catalonian separatism.
Primarily because Britain, by means of a historical accident and some help by British politicians, stayed out of the euro. But Catalonian independence is entirely the artifact of the European crisis. Think about it. Back in 2010, something between 10 and 15% of Catalans supported independence. Then you had the inane handling of the euro crisis. You had a great deal of indignation within Catalonia. The government of Madrid did its best to push the Catalans out of Spain by ending autonomy in 2010 in Catalonia.
Well, and they didn't continue with the further changes that we're going to make, but it was the Madrid government that
imposed
that.
They actually ended the process.
Yes, or further autonomy. They didn't end
autonomy. But the Madrid government, let me just give you another example.
The Madrid government did this, not Brussels.
Well, let me give you an example. My very good friend, the mayor of Barcelona, was elected with a mandate to improve social services in the city of Barcelona, which is a rich city with a lot of poor citizens. The city of Barcelona has a surplus, a permanent surplus. And she was going to use it in order to reduce local business taxes and to introduce some social programs. Madrid used the pretext of the fiscal compact to prevent the city of Barcelona from utilizing its surplus the way it wanted.
But that seems to be more to do...
A lot of Barcelona citizens into the bosom of the Catalan independence movement. Ada Colau herself is not a supporter of independence.
Let's not get into too much of the deal of Catalonia and Madrid. Is the EU doomed?
Well, I think the euro is doomed for exactly the reasons that Janos gives. There are lots of countries that should never have been in the euro, but for the moment they still are in the euro. We never hear anything about Greece anymore, but I assume that Greece is still in a lamentable condition. In Italy, in Spain, in Portugal, I think things are a bit better than they were, but there's still massive youth unemployment. I would say, just referring to the Catalonian thing, a very large amount of immigration, which people in Catalonia resent, a very high levels of youth unemployment, which people resent, have been factors in all of this. And I keep saying to young people in Britain, who are apparently so keen to be members of the European Union, go and tour Southern Europe and see what it's done to youth unemployment.
Do you think the European Union is doomed in the way Yanis is describing it?
I don't think the vision, which was even more recently laid out by Juncker in a speech saying, you know, we're going to have this federal structure and we're going to have armies into it. I don't think that can be the future at all. And I think it's interesting that whilst we see the leaders like Merkel and Macron and others at the summits, behind in these countries, particularly in Germany and elsewhere, proportional representation has led to the rise of far-right parties who then they have to do deals with, and those far-right parties are concerned about the EU, about Brussels, about immigration. So I can't see, if it survives, I don't see it surviving in the way that some in Brussels think it should, and expand in the way they think it should in the future at all.
There have been examples of the rise of far-right parties, Austria being the most recent example. You talk about the insurgent anti-European nationalism, but if you look at the big picture, if that was really true, why did a centrist win the French elections? Mrs. Merkel's forming yet another coalition government. Mr. Rutte is prime minister once more in Holland. Your party's still in power in Athens.
My former party,
all right, same thing. Mrs. May's always talking about how she wants Britain to be the EU's closest ally after Brexit. In the broader picture, in the big country, there isn't an insurgent anti-European nationalism.
Are you sure?
Well,
did you check the last presidential election result? Neo-fascist party got 35% of the vote.
Well, that's because it was down to the final two.
It
didn't in the first round.
35% of French people. Yeah. Last time they were in the final two against Chirac, they didn't manage to go even by 1% above their original
But
lowest.
They lost, and you know as well as I do.
Same,
I follow French politics.
12 million French people
very
did not vote.
Carefully. The National Front in France is now in chaos. Marine Le Pen is a busted flush, and Mr. Macron is president and controls the parliament.
Thankfully.
He's a centrist.
Thankfully.
So there isn't
thankfully.
An insurgent. You're exaggerating.
I'm not exaggerating at all. 35% is a very large percentage.
Sure, but then they went downhill.
Well, you haven't seen that yet. What is going downhill is the popularity of President Macron, whom I count as a personal friend, and whom I supported in the second round. But nevertheless, Macron has put all his eggs in the basket of what Caroline was alluding to, which is a federation, a federation light, a macroeconomically insignificant federation, but nevertheless, that's his project. And what is he basing it on? A kind of bargain with Angela Merkel. Mm. I will Germanize French labor and the French national budget, and you give me a federation light. He's not going to get that.
Probably won't happen.
And all that he's going to do is he will expend, he's expending, as we speak, his political capital. Who's going to be the beneficiary of that? I can tell you that even though Le Pen is going down, my friend of the left, Jean-Luc Mélenchon, with whom we are at odds because he's becoming increasingly populist, nationalist, and anti-refugee for that matter, is picking up the populist support. So if you look at the insurgent as you know, as a team in France,
it's always going to happen though, but it never quite.
The AfD is now
they got 13%
of the vote. Major force in the Bundestag when the FDP is already in government, and the FDP is far more Eurosceptic than Michael Portillo is.
I would suggest there's no hope of the European New Deal that Yanis is talking about. Maybe there should be, but it's not going to happen.
I think they've got a huge load of things on their plate at the moment, let alone dealing with us leaving the European Union. There are all these other factors going on in terms of how they coalesce together. I mean, I've always thought it was interesting when the Eastern European countries came in, what they came in with was and a desire to be part of the European Union, but also a very strong sense of self-identity, having left the orbit and the shadow of the Soviet Union. And I always thought that that tension was always there. And also for us is that it's always been looked at as the British problem in terms of the British public cynicism towards the EU. I think that's much more widespread across the European Union that some of the leaders would actually account for in terms of their politics.
I'm going to ask this question because I think it's, don't people like Yanis and British Eurosceptics like you, you always underestimate the Euro elite's determination to keep the show on the road. You know, people have talked for years, oh, the Euro's demise, it's going to break up, others will do Brexit, North and South will split. But they were even prepared to inflict mass unemployment in your country, in Greece, to keep the show on the road.
Yes, and they'll be prepared to do that to other countries in future. I thought authoritarian incompetence, the phrase used in your film, was accurate. But may I, Yanis Kulbe, a great Eurosceptic, and I'm a... I am a great Eurosceptic, but I don't dismiss for a moment the point that you also made in your film, that actually the problems that we face need to be addressed multilaterally, and that breaking up into little nationalisms is not the solution. I entirely agree with that. I am a Eurosceptic, but I didn't think our referendum was necessary. You said quite rightly that we had decided not to be in the Euro, and you've heard Caroline, she's on the same page as I am. None of us wants to be in the Euro. That was settled. We were not going to be part of this centralising European
project. So you would have been happy to stay in.
So we didn't need to have the referendum.
I wonder, since we've got you here tonight, Yanis, let me...
Mind you, I do not count myself as a Eurosceptic. I'm an enthusiastic Europeanist.
All right.
But except that the European Union deep establishment is doing all it can in order to destroy Europe.
OK, but I want to get on to this since we have you here, because you've negotiated with Brussels in the EU. And on the Brexit talks, you think, as I understand it, that the British don't understand what they're up against in these talks.
Well, the British, one can never generalise. I don't believe Theresa May.
No, I mean the people doing the negotiations.
Absolutely.
Don't.
Absolutely. We must not conflate the government with the people.
Well, that's what I meant.
No, from the beginning, it was abundantly clear to me, especially after my experience, that Mr. Barnier does not have a mandate to negotiate. Therefore, it was a gross error of judgment by the British government to even engage with him. There should be no engagement with this people. Barnier has a list of boxes that he needs to check one after the other. You've got to give everything to the EU of what the EU demands before you begin to have a conversation about what you want. This is not a way to conduct a negotiation. So there were always two clear options. The one that I disdain, the hardest of hard Brexits. I'm not supporting that, but at least it would be, in a sense, better than what's happening now, this humiliating process. Or the alternative, which I support, which is a Norway, you know, Britain doing a Norway for a period of 5 years, for one very strong reason, which I believe that we can see eye to eye with Brexiteers, Burkean Brexiteers, genuinely to restore sovereignty to the House of Commons, because at the moment you have not done that. At the moment the House of Commons has not even had a chance to debate the future relations between the EU and the UK. It hasn't even had a chance to transcribe European law into British law. and only a small conservative transition period, which involves a Norway-style agreement for a period of 5 years. And also, you know what it would do? It would cause the firing of Mr. Barnier, because a five-year period of that sort makes him redundant.
And he might not become the next president.
Let's not go into this. But it would also detoxify the situation, because Angela Merkel would breathe a sigh of relief. Mm. The ball will be in the court of the next chancellor, and therefore Theresa May and Angela Merkel could then talk sensibly
Very
to one another.
We shall see if the British government listens to you. Yeah. Mm. Janis, thank you. It's always good to come back and see us.
Thank you very much.